We've heard that Duterte is holding out for better times in the Philippines. He's just not giving up on the Philippines in spite of what's happened for the rest of the year. What do you make of his thoughts, Ramon?
Well, I can't help but agree with much of what's been said. So far, so good, I think, is the correct summary of where I feel we are.
So good about what?
So far, so good. Well, from the very start, the composition of the economic team enjoys, they are people with experience and enjoy a lot of respect and have hit the ground running. The 10-point economic program that was announced early on have elements that are exciting as far as the Philippine business community is concerned. The focus on infrastructure is most welcome and is something which we are looking out for with great anticipation. And maybe that's an area that needs to be focused on a little bit more, because while there is great anticipation that the pace of implementation will be significantly better than the past, perhaps the first year does not yet show that. So that's an area that needs to be looked at. And then the president came in also with great promise of better prospects for peace in Mindanao and also peace with the CPP and PA. And those are promises that still need to be fulfilled and really need to be worked on some more. Because peace in Mindanao will create a huge dividend in terms of opening up a huge area of the Philippines that has so far not enjoyed the same amount of growth that many other parts of the Philippines has enjoyed, particularly some of the poorer parts of Mindanao. Of course, there are parts of Mindanao that are also enjoying very vigorous growth. So that's my basis for saying so far so good. There are many positives, but there are also elements of some concern.
George, what about you? Do you agree with Ramon?
Yes. Good afternoon, Kathy. Well, I echo what Mon has said, and also the Chuda, the economist. Basically, you know, the president at the very start, he stressed that change is coming, and he's the game changer. I'd look at it even in the foreign his foreign policies has been very helpful to our country. He's very pragmatic, and he has the in mind about the economic growth for the country with the state visit of President to China and to Japan. He was able to get a huge amount of sum of ODA. And some of these are in the works now. We see some of the infrastructure projects that are ongoing will boost up our economy and at the same time make our country more competitive.
Yeah, but right at the get-go, the war on drugs really stuck out. It still sticks out. It's either you like it much or you don't like it much. Political polarization on the one goal that Duterte laid his political capital on. Ramon, what do you think about the war on drugs and what impact it's had on the way people or investors view the Philippines?
There are different approaches to fighting the drug menace. There are those who believe that it is a social menace, and it has to be dealt with a lot of tools involving a social approach. People who are into drugs have a whole range of problems that cannot be dealt with simply by applying harsh laws or harsh police measures against them. I happen to have relatives who have had drug problems in the past and have managed to get their lives back on track. And so it disturbs me when I see the very harsh measures that are being implemented and people continuing to die in the streets. So obviously that's not an approach that I personally believe in. But the president and his team have decided that that's the approach that they will use. Let's see how it plays out. So far, as far as I can tell, thousands of people have died, and a lot of tens of thousands of people have landed in jail. But I don't know what the long-term solution will be. What do you do with all of these people who are now in jail? What happens next to them? Do you keep them in jail for the rest of their lives? Do you subject them to drug rehabilitation programs? What's the program? It's not very clear in my mind. So that's an area that, to my mind, is sort of like a black hole. It's not something that I agree with in terms of the approach that this administration has taken. But hey, he's the president, and his administration has chosen this path. There are many who obviously agree with him, so let's see how it plays out.
But do you feel safer when you walk around in Metro Manila, for instance?
Well, I don't know if I can say that. I am not exposed, obviously, to the same kinds of dangers that people who live in very poor communities are. So on the whole, I would say the level of safety that I feel is not much different from what it was. But let me tell you that the strength of conviction and the strength of character that this administration projects is what I think leads to their popularity and the confidence of people in them, the ability to implement the solutions that they feel are right because they are, I guess, very strong in their convictions, is probably one form of leadership that, that people can look at and say with admiration that this is a team that will get things done. Whether you agree with their approach or not is something else, but they are a team that appears to be quite effective in getting things done and instilling fear in a lot of people. So in the sense that people are more careful about their moves, including the criminals, I suppose that that's a positive in terms of our society. That's a great intimidation factor in the way the administration operates as well.
George, on the matter of foreign policy, as you mentioned, there's been a pivot that happened. Oh, what impact has it had in the way you deal? The chamber deals with businessmen from overseas, the usual traditional allies. Now you've had to deal with Chinese partners, Japanese partners, and even Russian ones.
Yes. Well, we've been getting a lot of interest, you know, during the state visit of the president of China, Japan. Of course, the last one was in Moscow. I would say more promising with the Chinese businessmen and Japanese businessmen. With the Russians, I think it's just basically getting to know each other. It's our opening salvo during the trip of President Duterte. Of course, we know that was cut short, but we were happy that even without his presence, the audience from the Russian side was still in full force. Not only in Moscow, because from Moscow, we went to St. Petersburg. And to be honest, I was quite surprised because at first we thought that there would be very few turnout. But apparently, maybe it's an order from the top. The turnout even in St. Petersburg was quite good. So I think in the initiative that is done by the likes of Bank of China, wherein they want to finance the SMEs, and they have done that in the last April when they have their teams from Singapore, Malaysia, Hong Kong, English-speaking manager that came over and act as interpreter to link between to do the linkage between the Filipino and Chinese businessman. So we're very positive on that. Another B2B is forthcoming in the month of September.
When we talk about critical issues concerning the ASEAN, like say the West Philippine Sea, as well as the Maritime Code of Conduct, what is your assessment so far with the pivoting that he's made and also the kind of result that we've seen so far with this chairmanship of ASEAN 50? George.
Well, so far, you know, I just came back from the ASEAN Business Advisory Council meeting in Singapore. And I'm glad that in those meetings, what's on the table is all about business, all about collaborations with our ASEAN neighbors. I remember when I was with the president during the Vientiane forum, of course, a lot of he ruffled a lot of feathers when there were comments that were made. But apparently, our ASEAN neighbors looked at it from the point of view of that, you know, he shows a bit of leadership among the ASEAN. And I think that's reflective of his character. And now we can see that even with the problem in Marawi, you can see our neighboring countries like Malaysia and Indonesia, they're extending a helping hand. So we're happy also as Filipinos to have a president that is looked upon by other neighboring countries.
Ramon, what do you make of what George said? It's all about business, ABAC in Singapore, good or bad? I mean, what happens to geopolitics now?
I think there are positives that result from becoming more friendly with China and with Russia. And I think it makes eminent sense to be friends with as many of our, particularly our strong neighbors, as possible. China can be a very important economic partner of the Philippines, and should be. So on that score, I would be very supportive of this moves of the president. But it's on the other side of his policy pivot that I have I guess, greater concern. Why is it necessary to create enemies out of our former friends? In particular, he's used very harsh rhetoric against the Europeans, and in the past against the Americans before President Trump came on. So my thought is, let's be friendly with everyone, but particularly with those who have been our traditional friends in the past, who have shown that they have not only the capacity, but the willingness and the capability and desire to be helpful to us in very meaningful ways, and have been our strong economic partners for decades and decades. So while there is promise in this relationship with China and Russia, there is history and real concrete reality in our relationships with our past partners, which we should not, I think, turn away from. The West Philippine Sea story, I was one of those who looked at Albert Del Rosario with great respect and admiration. I felt that he was doing the right things because he was standing up to a great power and showing that the rule of law can be made to prevail even if pushed by a much smaller country. But having won that issue, I think we should certainly not set it aside totally. Okay, fine, maybe we should not emphasize it every time we come together, but it should certainly play a key role in our relationship with China as we move forward. It is not realistic to say that our relationship with China, unlike our relationship with the US, for example, has no strings attached. People in the administration like to say that our relationship with the US and Europe had many strings attached. Well, the relationship with China also appears to have a strings attached, which is, don't talk about the West Philippine Sea or the South China Sea and don't bring it up. Isn't that a major string? Isn't that a major condition for the relationship? So where is the mutual respect there? So I think we should balance the view that we have. Sure, it's good to be friends, but let's be friends with mutual respect for each other as well.
So what happens now to that code of conduct when they meet again in November? Is that a foregone conclusion?
A foregone conclusion in which direction? That it will not be talked about? That seems to be the desire of the current administration. As long as they do not do acts or say things that will negate the ability to invoke that victory in the future, I think maybe it's okay. I mean, if this administration wants to put it in the back burner and focus on economic relations and build up on that, I guess that's okay. I mean, there's nothing wrong with defining your priorities as you move forward. But let's not set it aside totally as if it doesn't exist and that it's not a factor. And let's certainly not do things that will negate it or make it impossible for us to invoke it in the future.
Yeah, we'll talk more about